الله. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا أرحم الراحمين. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, teach us what benefit us from what you taught us and increase us in knowledge. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless this gathering. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the people whom at the end of the gathering they will be told, get up, all your sins have been switched into hasanat, inshallah. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Every Thursday we discuss one of our greatest heroes in the past. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have rahmah on all of them, inshallah. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring from amongst us people who will be like them or even better, inshallah. Ameen. Today's hero is a man that was called سيد التابعين فقيه الفقهاء. Look at these titles. And these titles are not given by people. These titles are given by scholars to scholars. Unfortunately, some people call me a scholar. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Wallahi ya akhi, people like me, we only talk because of necessity. Because the ulama are gone. That's why we talk, ya akhi. When we say alim, you know what the word alim means? يعني, a real scholar. Scholars that dedicated their 50, 60, 70 years of life just for this deen. This is what alim is, subhanAllah. So this man was called by the ulama Sayyid al-Tabi'een. We all know that Tabi'een, we have Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we have the companions, and after the companions comes the Tabi'een. A Tabi'i is a person who did not see Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he saw the Sahaba. He could have, there are some characters, some men who were living at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but they did not see him. Okay, but they saw the Sahaba, so they are considered Tabi'een, even though they were at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but they never saw him. So Tabi'i means a person who saw the Sahaba. So our Tabi'i today, he is called Sayyidul Tabi'een, the master of the Tabi'een, Faqih al-Fuqaha, the scholar of the scholars. And he was born in the year 15 Hijri. 15 Hijri is on the time of which Khalifa? Umar radiallahu anhu, he was only 2 years. Umar was in Khilafa for 2 years when this scholar was born. This scholar's name is, anybody? Sayyid al-Tabi'een. MashaAllah, our Shaykh here, always on time, always on target. Sa'id bin al-Musayyib. Sa'id bin al-Musayyib. And you might see it as some other people call him Sa'id bin al-Musayyib, with a fatha on the ya. But the most common one is with a kasra, and this is what Al-Imam al-Dhahabi in Sir al-Nubala, he called him Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib with a kasra. So Sa'id, rahimahullah, he was born in the year 15 after Hijra, and died in the year 94. So he lived around 79, 80 years. Malik bin Anas narrated that Umar ibn al-Abdul Aziz will not take any decision without consulting with Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. Makhul radiyallahu anhu said, I traveled all over the land in search of knowledge and I did not meet anyone more knowledgeable than Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, the great Imam, rahimahullah, he said, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib is the best of the Tabi'een. Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma, the greatest sahabi, when he was, because Sa'id was born in Medina. He was born in the city of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was born in Medina, and Abdullah ibn Umar, when he's asked questions, he said, go ask Sa'id. In the presence of sahaba, the sahaba refers the people to Sa'id. This is how knowledgeable was Sa'id. He was, you could tell that he was a genius from a very young age. So his name was Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib bin Hazan bin Abi Wahab bin Amr bin Imran bin Makhzum. So he is from Qabilat Bani Makhzum. who is from Qabila Bani Makhzum. There are some evil people from this Qabila, and there are some great people from this Qabila. Name one evil person. The king of the evil ones, Abu Jahl. Even if you don't know from him, from Bani Makhzum, when you say he's the king of the evil ones, you should know Abu Jahl. And who is another great person from Bani Makhzum? Saifullah, Khalid bin Walid. So Bani Makhzum is a very well-known Qabila in Quraysh. His grandfather was a Sahabi. His grandfather saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and one time, the hadith is in Bukhari, he met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Masmuk, what's your name? He said, Hazan. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as if you're aware, when he meets people and he did not like the name, he used to change it, صح? So he said, La, innaka sahl, you are easy. Hazan, it means you're very harsh, you're very hard. So he said, no, you are sahl, you are easy. So the grandfather answered يعني, politely, because he's talking to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I will not change the name that my father named me. يعني, this is big. So Saeed said, wallahi, since that day, since the statement of my grandfather, the khushuna, the roughness was in all our dhurriya. All our families are rough. Because of that, he did not change his name, subhanAllah. Rasulullah ﷺ telling you, change your name, you say no, I want to stick to my father's name, subhanAllah. He was married to anybody knows who he was married to? Other than the Shaykh, yeah. Anybody else? Ah, mashallah. He was married to the daughter of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. So his access to hadith was easy. Father-in-law is the biggest muhaddith ever. Subhanallah. So he was, يعني, if you ask about Saeed, even though he has many specialties, he knows tafsir, he knows fiqh, but his main specialty is hadith without يعني, any specs. He was the best in hadith. The best in hadith. As a matter of fact, when you read some hadith, you see Saeed ibn al-Musayyib, an. So his name is in Bukhari, in Muslim, you see his name as a big, big muhaddith. Rahimahullah. He had three boys and four girls. So he was brought up in Medina amongst the Sahaba, and he was very well known that he does not fear anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He had the same story like Sufyan, rahimahullah, Sufyan al-Thawri, when it came to khalifas. Keep the khalifas away from me, from far to far. I don't want to hear them, I don't want them to talk to me, I don't want to talk to them. He was very allergic to khalifa. He has many students. Az-Zuhri, one of the greatest ulama, Qatada, Ali, Amr ibn Dinar, many, many students. And he had tremendous knowledge of hadith. Like I said, he was called the Faqih al-Fuqaha. Faqih al-Fuqaha. He had a specialty also that not too many people have. A lot of people come to me and they ask me, brother, can you please interpret this dream? Let me tell you one thing. Personally, I don't know anyone on earth that authentically interprets dreams. I'm not saying there's none. There might be some, but it's not something very common. Why? Because it's not a science of interpretation of the hadith. Let me go, Junaid, Samir, let's go study how to interpret the hadith and dreams. Does not work like that. So this is a fath from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something from Allah that He opens for the people when they become very close to Allah, so they can interpret what does seeing this in the dream means. And unless Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, if you see this is what it means, if you see this, what it means. And he had some kind of specialty about interpreting the dreams. He used to say, seeing fresh dates in a dream at its season is a sign of rizq, sign of provision. When you see fresh dates, now mashallah, tomorrow morning everybody's going to see fresh dates. In my country, I'm sure you've heard that too. Abu Abd al-Rahman, if you itch your hand, you're gonna get money, right? Who get this? This is Sheikh Abu Khalil from the store across the street. No, we have to get these things from authentic sources. So Imam Sa'id ibn Musayyib rahimahullah, he said, if you see fresh dates in a dream, at its season is a sign of provision. If a person sees in his dream that he was in shackles, that means steadfastness in the deen. A man came to Sa'id and he said, I saw in my dream that my teeth fell off into my hand and then I buried them. He said, if your dream is true, it means you will outlive some of the young people of your family. So yani, he had some specialty in interpreting dreams. He used to be very strict on the sunnah. Very strict. You know, keep in mind, still fresh with the Sahaba. So he saw a man performing two rak'ah after Fajr and making a lot of salat after Fajr. So he stopped him. Then the man said, Abu Muhammad, is Allah going to punish me for performing salat? You know how the people, when you tell them to stop something new in the deen or the bid'ah, they tell you, ya akhi, like one time, I see a brother, an imam, after every two rak'ah of Taraweeh, Allahumma salli, the whole masjid shaking, ala Muhammad. I thought first only two rak'ah, then four rak'ah, six rak'ah, eight. Then I went to the brother, so where did they get this from? The whole masjid is shaking, Allahumma, every two rak'ah of Taraweeh. Ah, so now salat on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is haram, huh? You people. Ya akhi, no, salat on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not haram. It's ibadah, absolutely. But to say it specifically and keep repeating it after every two rak'ah of Taraweeh, that means there has to be a dalil, so we could follow it. How about this? Okay. Now when we make ruku' after Subhan Rabbi al-Azim three times, we're going to start saying, all of us together, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. He said, no, you can't do that. Why? He said, Rasulullah did not do it. Exactly. Jazakallah khair. Same thing. Subhanallah. So here, when you tell somebody, he told him, what are you doing praying after Fajr? The only salat after Fajr for some madhahib is that if you miss the sunnah before Fajr, you're allowed to pray that. And that's it. After that, yani, between Fajr and Shuruq. And that's it. And even in Imam Abu Hanifa, I said, no, you have to pray it before. That's a different story. So this guy was praying يعني, continuously. So he told him, what are you doing? So the man said, يعني, haram يعني, to perform salat. I'm making salat. Fatiha, tasbih, takbir. So he said, so look at the answer of Sa'id. He said, no, it's not haram. No, he said, is Allah going to punish me for making salat? He said, no, he's not going to punish you for making salat, but he's going to punish you for going against the sunnah. That's a very good answer. You could use it. He said, he's not going to punish you because you're making salat, because he's going to punish you for going against the sunnah. Subhanallah. So he had a great, great, great manners, mashallah. He said, the companions wrote me this message. Give your brother's action the best interpretation as long as you have not seen any proof that would make you think otherwise. Subhanallah, this is one thing that we need to live by. Give your brother 70 more interpretations if you see him doing something until it's proven to you that it's otherwise. Otherwise, keep giving your brother the benefit of the doubt. A man came to him, this is his respect of hadith. A man came to him and he was extremely, extremely sick and he was lying down and he asked him about a hadith. So he sat up and spoke to the man. He said, I cannot narrate the hadith of Rasulullah while I'm sleeping. He sat up, subhanAllah, out of respect, just by mentioning the name of Rasulullah, by mentioning the words of Rasulullah, he felt that he has to sit up straight and be respectful. Listen to this. He never missed takbirat al-ihram for 40 years. Where? Masjid al-Nabawi. Each salat Abu Ali is how much? How much is each salat in Masjid al-Nabawi? 1,000. 40 years, not one salat missed. 20 of them, 20 years, Abdul Aziz, 20 years, he never saw the back of a musalli. He's in the first row or an imam. 20 years, never saw the back of a musalli. I was saying this around 7-8 years ago in one class. After that, on my this trip to New York, a brother came to me and said, remember when you were talking about Sa'id bin Musayyib and you said he never missed Salah, this and that? I told him, yeah. He said, you're the only one who knows who I am, but I'm going to tell you something, and you can go ahead and tell the people, but please don't mention my name, don't mention anything, and wallah, Allah is my witness. I'm not telling you for any reason except just to encourage the people. He said, since you said that, and of course I cannot do the 5 daily prayers. We are living in America. It's very hard unless you're out of your job and you live in the masjid. So he said, since that day, from 7 years till now, I did not miss one fajr in jama'ah. He's not a sahabi, he's not a tabi'i, he's a brother in Long Island. 7 years, not one fajr in jama'ah. First row, the first saf also. Ya akhwan, wallahi, we can do it. If he can do it, we can do it. And he lives like 10 to 12 minutes from the masjid. He has to take 3 highways to get to our masjid. And you know how much snow we get in New York? And sometimes it goes down to single digits or below zero. Subhanallah, ya akhwan, wallahi, let me tell you something. When you get addicted to this ibadah, wallahi, your life will completely change. I know most of the faces here, mashallah, they are all brothers of the Fajr. But for the brothers who don't come to Fajr, yani, the Imam just announced that Fajr at 6:45. If you are waiting for Fajr to become 8:30, 9 o'clock, I think you have to go either Alaska or somewhere. It's not, you don't belong in Dallas. It's not going to happen. And if you tell somebody in New York that I'm praying Fajr at 6:45, he will move, because this is out of the question. Out of the question. 6:45 for Fajr in Jama'ah? Please, ya akhwan, you come, you pray your Fajr, you listen to beautiful recitations, especially tomorrow, Jumu'ah. Hafiz Sajjad, he will read Sajda and Insan. And then you say your adhkar and you go to work. Allahu Akbar. Burika li ummatin fi bukuriha. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua. Rasulullah ﷺ made dua for the people who start their day early. He said, may Allah give them barakah, blessing in their time. So ya akhwan, let's make that habit. This is the best time to get used to that habit. 6:45. Yani, subhanallah. So he performed in this 79 years, he performed 40 hajj. 40 Hajj. It wasn't 5-star. 40 Hajj. Subhanallah. His experience with the Khulafa, his main Khalifa at his time was, anybody knows? Abdul Malik bin Marwan. Bin Marwan. He had an issues with him. One time, he woke up from his qailula, you know, siesta, sleeping in the afternoon. I guess this is something from the past, not something new. So he woke up and he told his main guard, go to the masjid, find me a muhaddith and bring him over here on board. Let him, you know, remind me. So this man, the guard, went and looked. He saw a lot of people, because Sa'id, from the house to the masjid, that's what he does. He used to have a business, because they don't like to ask anybody for money, but he never missed Salat in the masjid, and if you lose him, you find him in the masjid. So he went, he saw some people around him studying. He went and said like this. He told Sa'id, like this. You know. So Sa'id did not move. So the guy said, maybe he did not see me. So he went back to him. He said, did you see me? The Amir al-Mu'mineen wants you. Amir al-Mu'mineen wants you. He said, I don't want him. And I don't know what does he want me for. He said, he asked me for a muhaddith. He said, did he ask for me? He said, no, he asked for a muhaddith. He said, go and get somebody else. He said, are you crazy? You know, people at that time, you tell them Amir al-Mu'min wants you, they jump. They jump. So he went back to the Amir al-Mu'mineen. He told him, I saw this man and I did this, and then I asked him to come before he finished. So that was Saeed, right? Amir al-Mu'mineen, that was Saeed. It's okay, leave him alone. Then here's the main story that I mentioned one time when we were discussing, remember the marriage? Abdul Malik, the Amir al-Mu'mineen, ya akhwan, listen to the story. He went to Saeed asking for his daughter for Al-Walid. Al-Walid is Wali al-Ahd. He's going to take over. When Abdul Malik died, Walid took over. He became the Khalifa, Amir al-Mu'mineen, yani the president of all the everywhere. He refused. He refused. He was lashed 100 lashes and he still refused to give his daughter to the king, to the Khalifa, the Amir al-Mu'mineen. Then he looked in the crowd. He was missing one of his students. He said, where is so-and-so? They told him his wife died. So he went to his house. He said, I heard that your wife died. He said, yeah, Allah, I don't want to tell you because, you know, I don't want to bother you. I know you're studying, you're my teacher. He said, would you like to get married? He said, yeah, Sheikh, who's going to marry me? I have only $3. That's all I have. Who's going to give me his daughter? He said, me. He said, your daughter that you refuse to give to the Walid, you want to give it to me? He said, yes. Sit down. You, come over here. Shuhud, I'm the Wali. This is the Aris. Done. Married. The man went home. He cannot comprehend what just happened. I got married to the daughter of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, Sayyid al-Tabi'een, the greatest scholar. He cannot believe it. So excited, so happy. He's narrating the story. He said, I was fasting that day. I brought, all I have was some oil and some bread. And I was breaking my fast, and all of a sudden, the door knocks. I said, who? I heard somebody saying Saeed. He said, every Saeed on earth came to my mind except Saeed ibn al-Musayyib. Because this man is very well known from the masjid to the house, from the house to the masjid. That's it. So I open the door and I see Saeed ibn al-Musayyib. Yeah, Sheikh, he got very confused. He don't know what to say. So what are you doing here? You just asked for me. I come to you. Why you come here? He said, I married you, my daughter, and I hated that you will spend the night without your wife being with you. And he moved. Turned out that his daughter was just like, out of shyness, standing behind him. And he came like this, pushed her inside, and she went and went inside the house, and the father left. She's his wife. So he told his wife, just one second, stay here one second. He went to the roof of his house. Ya Alam, ya everybody, the daughter of the Musayyib is in my house. I don't know what to do. So who heard his mother? She said, wallahi, you will not touch her until I fix her for you for 3 days. So she took her for 3 days, fixed her up, did everything. And then she brought her and they consummated the marriage. Habibna wa sahabna, this man, 1 month did not show up to the halaqah. Honeymoon. He did not show up for 1 month. So when he came back to the halaqah, the father is asking, so how is our friend? He said, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. He said, ya Sheikh, don't think that in this 1 month I did not learn anything. He said, your daughter, mashallah, she is a copy of you, subhanallah. Everything that the father knows, he has already taught the daughter. And that was the reason why he does not want her to get married to these kind of people. Because he doesn't want to lose his daughter. When you are surrounded by this kind of luxury life, naturally by yourself, you're gonna move, deviate. So he said, I worked very hard for this girl and I don't want to lose her. So she'd rather be with this man than to be with the Khalifa. So this by the way, this marriage story is very, very, very well known. And the name of that husband is named Kathir bin Abi Wada'a. Kathir bin Abi Wada'a. Some of his saying is, he who is satisfied with Allah, he who is pleased with Allah's decree, people will be in need of him. If you are happy with what Allah has given you, يَفْتَقِرْ إِلَيْهِ النَّاسِ, the people will be in need to you. Subhanallah. Unfortunately, we are in need of others. Subhanallah. Shall I tell you, he said, shall I tell you of what's better than many optional salat and optional sadaqah? They said, yes, ya Saeed. He said, making peace between two quarreling people. And listen to this. This is deep. This is very deep. He said, it is enough, listen carefully, it is enough victory for a believer to see his enemy disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You understand? It is enough victory for a believer to see his enemy disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That by itself is victory. Because sometimes we plan how we're going to take revenge and do this and do that. While the guy is getting drunk every night, he does not pray. That by itself is victory to you. You don't have to do anything. That's the biggest punishment, that this guy doesn't pray. Subhanallah. So he died in the year 94 Hijra. And on his deathbed, when he was dying, you know, he was going back and forth in coma. Nafi', when he was in his coma, he asked him to move his face to the Qibla, move his body to the Qibla. So they moved him. So when he woke up again, he saw himself moving towards the Qibla. He said, who did that? Nobody, because they got scared. Who did that? When nobody answered, he said, it has to be Nafi'. Did you do that? He said, yes. He said, you think if I was not facing the Qibla all my life, facing it now is going to help? And he passed away. Subhanallah. He said, you think if I don't face the Qibla, because, you know, I don't know if you ever heard the story. It was very common a few years ago. They put this man in the grave and they turn him to the Qibla. They get up from the grave. The body turns back. Did you hear about the story? The man, they were burying him. They put him in the grave. They face him to the Qibla. The sheikh and the guy who's, you know, who dug, they go up to start throwing the soil. They see the body moves back away from the Qibla. They go down 3-4 times. Then the sheikh called his sheikh. He said, ya sheikh, every time I turn him to the Qibla, it goes back. He said, just go ahead, leave him. When he finished, he went and he asked his brother, said, tell me something about your brother that we just buried. Was everything okay with him? He said, yeah, everything was fine. Then after, you know, insisting and repeating the question, he said, my brother did not make one sajda to Allah all his life. He did not make one sajda. So turning him towards the Qibla is going to help? He did not pray all his life. Subhanallah. This is Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, rahimahullah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring from among us another Sa'id, inshallah. These are the stories we love to hear and love to imitate these people. Let's at least, maybe we cannot, because he was a muhaddith big time. I did not speak a lot about his hadith, but he was a great muhaddith. Maybe we could take at least the issue about praying in jama'ah, ya akhwan. Praying the salawat in jama'ah, Isha and Fajr. They are the salawat that most of us are able to do in jama'ah. Please, let's take, at least we feel like we are benefiting from these heroes, inshallah ta'ala. Let's adapt this new habit of praying Fajr in jama'ah. See you tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala, 6:45. Jazakumullah khair. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Shadan la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.